Welcome to the 8th Encuentro of Ibero-American Writers. I would like to tell everybody thank you for coming today to this event organized by Department of Foreign Language. First, I want to present to the chairperson of our department, Dr. Antonella Anzani, who's going to tell you the words of welcome. Okay.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Antonella Anzani, and I would like to welcome all of you to the 8th Encuentro of Ibero-American Writers at Queensborough Community College. For 8 years, a group of my colleagues in the Department of Foreign Languages and Literature, led by Dr. Laura Sabani, who's over there, have organized a series of cross-disciplinary conferences that have presented and analyzed different aspects of the culture of Latin America and Spain, including literature, criticism, art, and textiles and music. The guests of today's program are 5 poets from different Latin American countries who will read some of their poems and will discuss the creative process that brings their poetry to life. According to the mythology of ancient Greece, 9 different muses presided over poetry, music, dancing, and all the liberal arts. They were goddesses that were usually represented as young and beautiful virgins and were described as dressed in different attires, depending on the different arts over which they presided. They were universally worshipped, and no ancient poet would ever begin a poem without an invocation to the goddesses who presided over verse, so that they would inspire the poet and help him with his creation. Today, these ancient muses are all but forgotten. And yet, inspiration and insight are still central to the creative process. The poets presenting today will tell us about their modern day muses, about that force that inspires them and compels them to write. I would like to thank our speakers for accepting to participate and the members of the audience for attending this event. We have many students here today. Probably some of you might have had thoughts about writing poetry or stories. Some of you might be already writing, keeping a diary, or composing songs. I hope today's presentation will, will make you reflect about the writing process and will inspire you and encourage you to nurture any creative instinct you may have. I wish you all a great afternoon. My colleague, Dr. Madrigal, will now continue with the presentation of today's program. Please welcome Dr. Jose Luis Madrigal.
Good afternoon, buenas tardes. Welcome to the 8th Encuentro. I look around and I see a few students of mine from 111. Encuentro, in Spanish, may mean meeting, encounter, gathering, but also it means I find, right? Eureka, I find. So I hope that you will find this encounter entertaining, interesting, will attract your interest or kindle your curiosity. Our panelists are 5 distinguished poets who are going to talk, are going to read their poems, but also they're going to talk about the creative process. And I have to tell you that for me, the creative process is sometimes as interesting as the product, the book itself. I will give you a very simple example, a big example. I'm very fond of a 19th century French novelist, Flaubert. You have Madame Bovary. Now, if you read Madame Bovary, this is a masterpiece. It's beautiful in every page. No question about it. I love it, in French or in a translation. But along with the text, we have a whole body of letters, of papers, of notes written by Flaubert at the time that he was writing the novel. And it's absolutely fascinating because you enter somehow the workshop of the writer. Well, in a smaller scale, I'm sure that our panelists are going to share with us the same experiences, because every artist, no matter the size, goes through the same struggle as Flaubert or as any other great writer. Now, at the back of my mind, of course, is the Mario Vargas Llosa. I say that because Mario Vargas Llosa, who was awarded the Nobel Prize just last month, is an enormous admirer of Flaubert. And, well, literary prizes, including the Nobel Prize, sometimes, you know, are awarded not to the very best or to the very good. But in this case, I can assure you, we can rest assured that the Academy, the Swedish Academy, did the right thing. Because Vargas Llosa is, in my opinion, and in the opinion of many others, one of the greatest, if not the greatest, Latin American writer in the last 40, 50 years. Certainly one of the greatest of his generation, along with García Márquez. Is great not only for his novels. If I have to have a ranking of the best 10 novels in the last 100 years in the Spanish literature, I would put at least 3 novels, if no more, from Vargas Llosa, in my opinion, of course. But Vargas Llosa is not only a novelist, but also a fantastic journalist and a wonderful literary critic. If you are interested in Madame Bovary, I advise you to read his study on the book. In short, Vargas Llosa is a man of letters. Anyway, let's introduce now Dr. León, who is from Peru, and probably he will tell you something more about Vargas Llosa. Thank you very much.
I like to remind you first, you didn't sign when you arrived here. Try to do it at the end of this event before you leave, please. The Nobel Prize is one of the most important and prestigious literary awards in the world. Latin Americans, accustomed to almost never win, especially Peruvians, now we are very proud of this year's winner, the Peruvian writer Mario Vargas Llosa. Although he's from Peru, I believe this award belongs to all that part of America that speak Spanish. Well, somehow this award confirms also Latin America is a nation or many nations who for centuries have a literature and a cultural universe to offer and that the world has begun to discover. Further evidence of this is the presence of these great Latin American writers show us today, who I would like to invite to sit over here in front of you. You come to the table, please.
Primero.
No, no.
Sonia.
Yo voy primero, entonces.
Yeah.
Okay.
En orden.
Okay. Sonia. Okay. It's an enormous pleasure to first present the writer Sonia Rivera Valdez. She's a poet from Cuba. She's also president of Latino Artists Roundtable, LART, a cultural organization established in New York. She is currently professor of Latin American literature at York College. She received the prestigious Casa de las Americas Literature Award for her book, Las Historias Prohibidas de Marta Veneranda. She published also in 2003, Historia de Mujeres Grandes y Chiquitas. Sonia Rivera.
Muchas gracias. I didn't expect that. Well, first, thank you very much for the invitation to Julio and each person who participated in the organization of this event. Well, the first thing is that I am sorry, but everything I brought for reading is in Spanish. I didn't bring anything in English. I tried to select the shortest story I have, because usually I don't write short stories, very short. They are long. And also I brought a chapter, you know, just an excerpt from the last novel I have finished right now. But I don't know, since we are, you know, five persons, and they told me 10 to 12 minutes, and I try to adjust, you know, to what they say, then I am going to read the short story that is not even, it's not typical of what I write, but here it is. And then I'll speak, do you think that was okay, Julio, after that, about the creative process, and you can ask me anything. If I can answer, you know, I will answer. And if I can't, you know, I try. Believe me, I try. Más lejos. Está muy... ¿Aquí oyen? Ok.
Mejor.
Sí. ¿Mm? Ahí oyen. Ok. Este es un cuento. This is a short story that it was published in one occasion. It's practically inédito and published. And I am putting together with a collection of other stories that I have from, sometimes they have 15 years old, you know. Other ones, they are not so old, and I am putting together in a volume. And the title is Rodeada de Arces. Soñó que un hombre tocaba la puerta. A la puerta de aquella casa rodeada de arces, recién estrenada en la vida diurna 2 meses atrás, a la que se había mudado decidida a borrar el cansancio de demasiadas madrugadas insomnes, por las que culpó durante 10 años a los bomberos, cuya estación lindaba con su edificio. Se mudó decidida a olvidar las delgadas agujas manchadas de sangre, abandonadas al borde de la acera que pisaba cada mañana. Cansada de tropezar con ellas, de estar obligada a ver, al regresar a casa, en el portal del edificio ruinoso de la esquina, a quienes habían usado la noche anterior las agujas que pisó aquel día, usando las que pisaría al siguiente. Dispuesto a olvidar el temor de que un día, quienes no podían prescindir de ellas las necesitaran, carecieran y ella estuviera a su alcance. Hastiada de la prisa constante y tal vez su soledad, rodeada de arces, se le haría menos sola. El carro, dijo el hombre, se había detenido frente a la casa y necesitaba usar su teléfono, llamar a la compañía de seguros. Vio el carro azul metálico estacionado frente a la puerta que daba entrada al jardín. El hombre vestía camisa cuadros, pantalones jeans, y al mirarle a los pies observó el símbolo de Nike a los lados de los tenis. Tenía la frente ancha y el pelo gris, largo, anudado en una trenza. Los ojos grandes, de mirada clara, eran buenos. No le cupo duda y lo mandó a pasar mientras ensayaba en silencio la frase con que le ofrecería té o café. Soñó que un hombre tocaba la puerta. A la puerta de esta casa, a la que se había mudado en la vida diurna 6 meses atrás, y donde despertaba sobresaltada en las madrugadas por el canto de los colimbos, cuyo sonido se le hacía lúgubre ahora. Esta casa ausente de calles con faroles y de esquinas con mercados para comprar leche a altas horas de la noche y el periódico los domingos. Sentada frente al lago, en tardes que duraban demasiadas horas, le dio por recordar las puestas de sol que contemplaba sentada en la escalera de incendio desde la ventana de su cuarto y en la perfecta simetría este-oeste de su calle. Le dio por pensar que jamás los de las venas gruesas en los brazos y las llagas en las piernas se acercaron al verla pasar. Nunca. Su soledad, rodeada de arces, se le estaba haciendo más sola. El hombre dijo que el carro se había detenido frente a la casa. Necesitaba usar su teléfono, llamar a la compañía de seguros. Sí, un carro azul metálico estaba detenido frente a la puerta que daba entrada al jardín. El hombre vestía camisa cuadros, pantalones jeans, y al mirarle a los pies observó el símbolo de Nike a los lados de los tenis. Tenía la frente ancha y el pelo gris, largo, anudado en una trenza. Al enfrentar los ojos, observó su fondo turbio y no le cupo duda. Pidió disculpas por tener el teléfono descompuesto y cerró la puerta. Un hombre tocó a la puerta. Necesitaba usar tu teléfono. Por favor. Vestía camisa cuadros, pantalones jeans, y al mirarle a los pies observó el símbolo de Nike a los lados de los tenis. Tenía la frente ancha y el pelo gris largo anudado en una trenza. La mujer estaba sola y al mirarle los ojos castaños fue incapaz de leer en ellos. Miró hondo, buscando una respuesta en las pupilas. El hombre continuó explicando y ella de pie frente a él, los labios extendidos como si sonriera. Nada en aquellos ojos resonaba cierto o falso dentro de ella. Las certezas pertenecen a los sueños, se dijo, siempre con los labios extendidos, como si sonriera. A mí me dijeron, ¿verdad?, en un email, yo tengo aquí por ejemplo, que contestara preguntas concretas sobre cuándo comencé a escribir, qué me inspira. Yo puedo decir muy rápidamente, yo tengo un ensayo muy corto que acabo de mandar para una antología que se va a publicar en Roma, que me dijeron exactamente que escribiera qué significaba para mí escribir en Nueva York. Pero como yo soy muy mala para contestar preguntas precisas. Claro, puedo responderles que el primer cuento que escribí lo tenía 7 años. No era Sor Juana Inés de la Cruz ni nada de eso. No eran esas las circunstancias. Pero sí tenía 7 años y era un plagio. ¿Qué voy a saber a los 7 años que era plagio, verdad? Pero sí era una versión habanera de una historia de los hermanos Grimm que mi mamá me contaba y era mi favorita. Mi madre, que siempre digo que era una cocinera, como cocinera, ama de casa, no hubiera pasado ningún examen con buena nota, pero era muy buena contadora de cuentos. Yo creo que eso, yo siempre digo que me dio más, probablemente en aquel momento no, todas las comidas sabrosas que me dejó de hacer, pero tanto que me inspiró con otras cosas, como leerme e inventarse, inventaba los finales de los cuentos. Y yo escribí mi cuento. Yo vivía en unas condiciones en La Habana, en una casa de vecindad, en una casa que yo siempre digo que era dysfunctional, pero mild dysfunctional, no era un dysfunctionality tan grande, no era tan, tan enorme. Porque, bueno, no había violencia doméstica, pero había violencia verbal. Mi papá no era alcohólico, pero era jugador y jugando póker gastaba mucho dinero. Bueno, no escribí más, escribía y guardaba. Hay personas que tienen un afán muy grande, la mayoría de los escritores y las escritoras, y sobre todo los escritores, más que las escritoras, y está pues famoso en las escritoras, tener guardado una gaveta. Hoy en día yo creo que menos, pero bueno, un montón de poemas y de historias. Los hombres generalmente, yo digo que muchas veces las mujeres escribimos historias, poemas, cuentos, o sea que está muy mal, las guardamos. Y los hombres a veces un poema o un cuento lo publican 60 veces y le dan vuelta y vuelta. Pero es que es cierto, es así. Entonces, para realmente ya con el objetivo de publicar y que quería que se leyera, lo empecé a hacer, fíjense, en los 80. Y pensé muchísimo, tenía ya 40 años y pensaba en Teresa, en Santa Teresa de Jesús, que tenía 47 cuando empezó, cuando hizo su libro, ¿verdad? El libro de la vida por orden del confesor. Y para mí fue por orden de interno, de regresé a Cuba después de 14 años de haber estado ausente. Y siempre digo, y sobre todo los cubanos en los ojos, que vi muchas cosas que me gustaban. Y me empecé a preguntar que de verdad, verdad, ¿por qué me había ido de Cuba? Porque esa respuesta fácil de cuando yo llegué, que ya no me cuadraba. Y entonces empecé a escribir, pero para mí escribir, y estaba leyendo ya algo de Mercé Rodoreda, que estoy enseñando y es una de mis escritoras favoritas. Yo no puedo escribir, para mí escribir crónicas, las he escrito, escribí una cuando fui a Perú, por ejemplo, que me gusta mucho, pero no me sale escribir una historia, escribí un cuento, El beso de la patria, que se ha hecho, yo digo un cuento que ha caminado solo, de cuando yo tenía 7 años, y para, en parte para desmentir esa idea de que antes del 59 Cuba era un paraíso para algunos, y era, no era un paraíso para la mayoría del pueblo de Cuba. O sea, así es como escribo. Si ustedes quieren, les leo. Si tengo algunos minutos, si tengo 4 o 5 minutos, o ya, o me callo. 4 minutos, ok. En 4 minutos les voy a leer 2 párrafos de esto que escribí. Se lo voy a seleccionar, tiene 3 páginas, yo les voy a leer unos párrafos. Dice, ¿qué significaría escribir si viviera en cualquier otro sitio? Quiere decir, no en Nueva York, que es donde me dijeron. No lo sé. Desde que escribo con la intención de publicar lo escrito, lo he hecho en Nueva York. Pero puedo decir qué significa para mí escribir, escribir a secas. Significa hacer algo que tengo que hacer para poner mi vida en orden. Puedo haber hecho muchas cosas y si no he escrito lo que esa voz interior me ordena, no me pide, me ordena, siento haber faltado un deber. A pesar de ese sentimiento de culpa, lo que llega al papel es una fracción de lo que escribo en mi cabeza, donde además edito. Lo que sucede mientras camino las 7 cuadras que van de mi apartamento a la estación del metro. Lo que sucede yendo en el metro mientras me dirijo a York College, donde enseño. Lo que sucede mientras hago café por la mañana, mientras me inyecto la insulina de cada día, mientras tiendo la cama. Ahí sin falta pienso en mi mamá, ya que este era uno de los pocos quehaceres domésticos de su agrado. Ahí también veo y escucho la vieja aurora en Cuba, decenas de años atrás, afirmando rotunda que el ángel de la guarda no entra donde hay camas sin tender. Al llegar a York College y comenzar a dar clases, aún antes de comenzar en los pasillos, no me enfrento, me sumergo en el mundo de mis estudiantes. La mayoría inmigrantes o hijos de inmigrantes. Cada una de esas vidas amerita una novela de 2 tomos. Una de esas que las editoriales rechazan ahora por ser demasiado cara su publicación, a menos que se escriba para uno de los concursos en que los autores se ven forzados a rellenar hasta sobrepasar las 300 páginas. Y así el día transcurre observando la vida, recordando, observándome adentro con esta distancia desde la que me ha dado por verme según han ido amontonándose los años. Y como todo lo que veo, lo que escucho, lo que huelo, lo que toco, lo que recuerdo, lo que imagino, lo converso conmigo en palabras calladas, voy escribiendo y editando, poniendo en orden en cuanto me llega del mundo de afuera y del de adentro, porque también edito mis memorias. Y eso es lo que me motiva a sentarme y pasar frente a la computadora horas en las que podría estar caminando por Chinatown, algo que tanto me gusta hacer, porque de entre los olores y visiones, sonidos y memorias que percibo, van tomando forma personajes y tramas cuyas historias al construirse van a decir algo que considero significativo sobre la vida. Y me urge compartir esas historias. Y de esos mundos que creo, de los que soy la creadora, soy dueña, no solo de la conducta y el destino de los personajes, lo soy de ese universo entero, libre para determinar a qué hora del día o la noche van a suceder los hechos, si en otoño o invierno, cómo está decorado cada apartamento que imagino, dónde se encuentra el edificio y en qué condiciones. Soy dueña de los colores y de los olores. Puedo hacer a los personajes acostarse con quien les apetezca, rechazar a quien les plazca o actuar de manera coherente o incoherente de acuerdo a sus circunstancias. Circunstancias y actuaciones creadas por mi imaginación, que a la vez está regida por mi visión de la vida. Y mi visión de la vida es intrínsecamente trágica, por bien que te vaya en ella. Pero los años que estás sobre la tierra son extremadamente disfrutables para unos pocos y extremadamente dolorosos, cuando no tendría que serlo para gran parte de la humanidad. Muchas gracias. Porque...
Okay. If you have any question, we will have the opportunity to ask the questions at the end of the reading of the writers. Okay. Now is the turn of Lila Semboraín. Lila is from Argentina. She is a critic and poet. She is the author of several poetry collections, like Abre Te Sésamo Debajo del Agua, 1993, Usted, 1998, Guardianes del Secreto, 2002, Malvas, Orquídeas del Mar, 2004, Rasgado, 2006, and other numerous publications. And also, she directs the Creative Writing in Spanish program at New York University. You, Lila.
Okay. Thank you very much for inviting us to be here. I think this is a great event to promote the creative writing around the New York area in Spanish also, no? The creative writing in Spanish. I also will read in Spanish, but mainly I have chosen a couple of poems from a book called Biopoema, that it's related to the process of writing, to the creative process. And this book, Biopoema, as the name suggests, has to do with the biography, but also biology, and the biology, the poetry of biology in a certain way. So I have looked at the body, entering into the body, and at the same time looking at works of art, other creative, other writers also. I comment on other writers, but everything, it's related to the internal process of creating with words. And with images also, and the relationship also between images and words. So, this is the first poem. De una cara sale una línea que recorre un garabato abstracto, como si la propia subjetividad fuera un garabato abstracto, algo a lo que se atina por juego. Dejar fluir la mano en el reconocimiento de una sensibilidad que se devana en el tiempo de selección de cada espacio, de cada documento. Un tiempo íntimo que construye una expansión, una figura que adquiere el hechizo de la mesa de madera y la lámpara, de las cintas scotch y la tijera, el trabajo de recortar y de pegar. Sería llamarlos borradores, errores que se admiten y páginas en blanco. La posibilidad de despegar y que quede allí un título sosteniendo una ausencia, una referencia sin imagen, como un deseo que se quiere salvaguardar del olvido, un gesto que debe despejarse en este recorte que se restituye a la memoria. Y más acá de la obra, la vida del artista como un garabato abstracto, desentrañando lo uno de lo otro, de lo informe la pasión, de la compañía el secreto. En estos textos visuales, en estos poemas visuales, casi sin palabras. Adentrarse en el mundo de las células con el ojo de Terry Winters, es un artista norteamericano, en donde se unen imágenes con palabras como mórula, racimo de células apeñuscadas, conglomerado de pigmentos que se extienden como glóbulos voladores en un espacio primordial, enfocando el ojo hacia la construcción molecular, no así de la molécula de tinta, porque la tinta con que se escribe no conforma la textura de la sucesión de palabras, sino algo que tiene más que ver con el procesamiento que realizan las neuronas para ordenar y consignar una abstracción. ¿Qué mórula instigó este deslumbramiento? El lenguaje se esparce en un caldo de fluidos aglutinados o atravesables, como redes que explayan el placer, de materias que seducen pigmentos o formas mecánicas de construcción, para dar una cualidad emocional a las palabras, que no quieren ser inscriptas en su literal obviedad, y muestran en su flotante divagar una radiación cromática y una consistencia vaciada de sentido que chorrea volumen. En todos lados hay gentes y voces, y más acá hay algo, en la tierra, en los árboles, en el resoplido de una yegua o en la tijereta que pasa, aquí, donde un lenguaje se dibuja en la magnolia, como un jeroglífico de oro entre las hojas, letras de un alfabeto de luces estampadas en las ramas, un vocabulario de secretos evidentes, de vetas en el tronco, fríos inviernos y veranos de miel y polvo en las chicharras, reconocer el fraseo de los pájaros y su confabulación poderosa con la rama, el terciopelo de la luz, los signos, los acertijos que le hablan a mis genes, a mis células abiertas, a un horizonte de caballos quietos, meneando las colas al celeste, internados en el pasto con sus orejas paradas, el olor de la gramilla, el agua en las aguadas, el bebedero incierto y el molino, el glosario en las membranas, en las vías del tren o en las palomas, en los gorriones tal vez o en los jilgueros, el campo desechado, la soja enardecida, el cielo desatado en pomposos nubarrones, y vuelven las marcas que quieren ser borradas, como esas cicatrices de los árboles o los archipiélagos de cáscaras que dejan en sus troncos. Acaricio lentamente esa textura. La turbulencia de los astros se asemeja a una locura. Así volvemos a los titubeos certeros del tacto, a la hinchazón que produce el borboteo. El último. Establecer esa distancia, ese mínimo de distancia, que hace desear siempre el otro lado, y no poder estarse quieta cuando las palomas se acercan a un estado de quietud que se confunde con los bordes. Well, I thought this was kind of appropriate for this event, for this reading, in the sense that it connects with a moment or with the sensations that developed probably in myself when I'm writing. Writing is a process of investigation for me. It's a process of knowledge. I try to learn with my writing. I have a question, I have a compulsion, something that Carlos Vázquez knows what it means here. I have a compulsion, I have something that I need to understand, and I try to solve it. It's never solved completely through the process of writing. In this particular book that I was working, I had this is a book I wrote after 9/11, after another book that I wrote after 9/11, is the second book. It's not related at all to 9/11, but it has to do with the idea of reconstituting the destroyed texture of the relationships, like 9/11 being something that had cut so many lives and so many things in the world. So I was obsessed with looking at different ways of how beings, or through art, or in nature, or through the body, how connections were made. So in a way to recover this sense of absolute disconnection, disruption of death, and not only 9/11, but of war and all those times and terrible times that we were and are still living. It's not related directly to it, but it's a way of responding, trying also to get to the reader to connect with those spaces of connection, of, the borders between the membranes and how everything se traspasa. I don't know how to say the word, no? Like
overlaps,
no? So this has always been, this is like a model maybe of my process of writing. As I said before, I don't know if it was like that when I started writing. I think I wrote a horrible poem when I was 15 years old. I still remember it, and I will never say it to anybody. But then I wrote a little book when I was in my 20s also. That book was lost. I did it all by myself. I published it myself. I did only 4 issues of that little book. Fortunately, it's also lost. I don't know where. And writing is an investigation, and as I say, but it's also a pleasure. It gets to this relationship to language, something that we learn through our mothers. We learn when they sing cradle songs to us, and that is a lot of texture of language. We don't have the meaning, but we have the sounds, and we have the tone of the voice, and we have a rhythm of the voice. And this is something that is also very important for me: voice, rhythm, and sound. And in a way, creating is a way also of soothing, like in the, ¿cómo se dice? Canciones de cuna.
Lullabies.
Like in the lullabies, no? Poetry is like a way of soothing the angst that everybody has. And this is only what I have to say.
She's a professor at New York University. She has many publications. She published Memorias de Electra in 1984. I think it's her first book, Placer Fantasma, 1993, Onyx, 2001, Pes, 2005, and she has also a critical book called Soberanía y Transgresión, César Moro, published in 2008. With you, Mariela.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me over. Thank you to Laura and to Julio León and for all of you for being here. I am, Julio didn't mention the last book. I have published so far 5 books of poetry in 25 years, so it makes it even, you know, because I'm very, a bit obsessed with numerology and all that. So this is my 5th book that came out early this year. The title is Morir es un Arte. And at a certain point after I've published this book, I had the idea that my work had come full circle in the sense that it, throughout those 5 books, from Memorias de Electra, published in 1984, until Morir es un Arte, I had addressed the same topics that were topics that, of course, obsessed me as a writer. This pair of love and death, especially passion love, l'amour passion in French. I am very fond of surrealism, I've always been, and the author I worked on for my dissertation that then was turned into a book is César Moro, a Peruvian writer who wrote both in French and Spanish. So love and its pair, its couple, which is death. I've always seen a lot of connections between both of them. And also disease and the state of being ill for me gives us, like, it puts us in a space which is like the ideal space for contemplation, for being in yourself, within yourself, only with your body, and being able to contemplate and see from a certain state of mind at the same time. And also, I have from the beginning wondered what poetry is about. I've written a few Ars Poetica, these were my topics. And I realized that most of my poems were like a way of expressing these topics, but I hadn't, even though I go back to them, I wanted to try to be more faithful to something that always was there from the beginning when I started to write, which is this music that I hear within myself. Because I always think that I have like a musical pattern, which is, of course, the receptacle where my voice is, where it comes from. And so I wanted to be, in this new book that I am composing now, I won't tell the title because of, I'm a bit superstitious, of course, so, but in this book that I'm working on right now, I wanted music to be the key element. And of course, it gives me a very broad space for experimenting. For one thing, I am writing lengthy poems now. My poems are usually 1 or 2 pages long. And so I'm working with rhythm, but at the same time, the topics that are have always been important to me are still there. What I'm gonna read right now is one of the last poems I've written. And it was started last year when I traveled to Uruguay for the second time, to Montevideo. And I was, I am very fond of Montevideo and of the people from Uruguay in general. The first time I visited was because I was invited to a festival where Peru was the guest country, and I was part of the committee, you know, the group that of Peruvian poets that went there. And then I went back last year. And there is an avant-garde poet from Peru, Juan Parra del Riego, who went to Montevideo at some point of his life, and he fell in love with a very young and beautiful woman from a city in Uruguay, which is called Pan de Azúcar. And this avant-garde crazy guy, Parra del Riego, kidnapped Blanca Luz when she was 16 on his motorcycle. They eloped together to Montevideo, and it was a big scandal, of course. So when I was on the plane, it was last August, I all of a sudden realized, already on the plane, always being scared of flying, but that doesn't stop me from traveling anyway, I realized that on top of that, there was a swine flu going on big time in Rio de la Plata. So, you know, I had this notebook computer that I had just bought, and I was like, what the hell am I doing flying to Montevideo when everybody's crazy about that swine flu? So in a way to soothe myself, to use a word that Lila just used, I opened my pocket, what is it, my notebook, how do you call it, notebook computer? Yeah, and I started to write. And in the poem that I'm going to read, it is un cuaderno negro, o un cuaderno de rayas negras en el aire, but it's really, what is black is the computer itself. And of course, there is, you know, there are lots of references to Parra del Riego and his passion, love for Blanca Luz. And also, Parra del Riego dedicated a whole collection to this woman. It was called Blanca Luz, precisely. And he mentions el traje lila de Blanca Luz, like the velvet, the purple dress. So I use that image repeatedly in the poem. There's a lot of recurrence in the poem because it is a lengthy poem. So in order to keep the rhythm, I have to go to anaphoric repetition and go back to the topics, you know, the leitmotifs. And what else? Before I read the poem, because it's a bit lengthy, one more thing that I wanted to tell you is that I wrote it on, you know, while flying. So it's dated as Alturas de Sudamérica. Because I wrote it while flying. And also, there are two words that are from Uruguay. Terutero, which is like a spinning top, and the voz at the end, which is the way in which people from Rio de la Plata address each other instead of tú. And I'm gonna read the poem now. Okay. Dame tu traje lila, Juan Parra del Riego. Estoy volando a 1,000 pies de altura, Juan Parra del Riego. Ingreso, alcanzo a penetrar, y luego, con el dedo en el mapa, he de bajar a la ciudad más meridional del continente y he de hundirme en tu historia, medir el ritmo de tus pasos en invierno, Montevideo en la década del 20, el momento exacto de la enfermedad. Aquí el aire se hace irrespirable, hiere las fosas nasales, tus cavernas. Para evitar tu fragilidad me cubro, pero en la nave giran las toses de los otros, la bacteria. Yo también me arriesgo como tú, y al buscarte tal vez solo encuentre tu sombra o apenas en aquel cementerio marino una tumba rodeada de 11 ficus como 11 cracks de fútbol. Quiero ver eso, la danza de los ficus en el viento, las rodillas de los hombres rodeándote, gradín coronando el paisaje. Busco la belleza de los cuerpos, el tintineo del carnaval entre tus versos, el terutero y ese traje lila que Blanca Luz vistió mañana. Huyo de lo innombrable, pero me he trepado a este avión para encontrarte. Y tú, ¿de qué huías viajando de Lima a Montevideo? ¿A qué sueño te diste? ¿En qué consistió tu renuncia? Y aquí estoy sentada en la cabina, los pasajeros me estornudan en la cara y yo siento que en cualquier momento podría contagiarme. Tal vez al llegar me espere el neumococo, entrará en mí con la misma suavidad de las aeromosas que ahora me atienden, pero no saben, no pueden entender. Quiero amar las palabras que tú amaste y con el cuello descubierto, el cuello en alto, voy a respirar ese mismo aire que hace años te perforó los pulmones. Mientras besabas a tu bella blanca luz, le hacías el amor como si el mal no existiera, el contagio no existiera, la nada fuera una broma de los portadores de malas noticias. Yo también tuve un muchacho de piel parecida a la mía, de ojos grandes y negros como los míos, tierno al besarme, al morderme los labios, la saliva podía seguir fluyendo y no temía al contacto de su sexo con el mío desnudo junto a mí. No llevé un traje lila, ni su voz me cantó, ni su palabra, pero hasta el lecho me trajo la más pura presencia de su melancolía. Y fui entonces la madre y fui la hija, jugué con mi muchacho a entreverarnos, respirando uno en el otro, en ese robo de las identidades en que su cuerpo era mío y su aliento se confundía con mi exhalación. Entonces dime, Juan, si tus huesos, ancianos pero hundidos en el cementerio del buceo, igual que este avión se hunde entre las nubes o el oxígeno se esfuma, dime si al acercarme a tus huellas o cuando empiece a toser en Montevideo, perseguida por ese virus que rodea la ciudad y viaja tanto o más acelerado que su mar, dime si en el fondo no será que me aproximo a la muerte. Hace rato hemos cruzado el centro de la Tierra y antes de girar a la derecha o a la izquierda, una vez más volaré sobre el techo de la patria, pero tú te fuiste de esa patria, tus huesos tampoco están ahí. Alguien enciende una luz como podría encender un cigarrillo, solo que fumar está prohibido, solo que la luz encendida es el fuego solar del atardecer, y veo en ese intenso amarillo la forma de tu vida radiante hasta el delirio antes de que ardieran tus pulmones a los 30 años de edad. Y si el fin de la vida no fuese ese contagio de la gripe, sino la propia caída del avión, y estas fueran las últimas líneas para ti, Parra del Riego, mientras vuelo en tu busca y no sé todavía lo que encuentre, aunque presiento. Todo huele a final en esta tarde cuando el cielo se oscurece pero brilla, intensamente lila como la luna que preside el horizonte, así como tu amada presidió tus días y tus noches, tus moradas moribundas y mortuorias. Y no sé, no puedo ver quién se sienta a mi lado, quién tose o estornuda, quién irá a contagiarme o a salvarme como a ti no pudieron, pero ahí estás en ese cementerio rodeado de los ficus y en tus notas estás en la alegría de tus ritmos, polirritmos, y en lo alto yo veo esa dinámica celeste de tu vida que fueron tantas vidas en solo 30 años de acelere y soledad. Y quiero cerrar este cuaderno de rayas negras en el aire, pero aún no consigo recordar tu melodía, el contrapunto celoso de tus líneas, y quiero decirte que ya llego acaso a visitarte, a ponerte unos gladiolos en la tumba, ahora que la noche ya llegó. Tal vez sea que busco el neumococo o un gesto de ternura en el cielo uruguayo como vos. Y me olvidé de un detalle que lo voy a decir a posteriori. Parra del Riego vivió 30 años y murió de tuberculosis. Entonces la idea de la enfermedad pulmonar era como también una recurrencia obsesiva en el poema. Bueno, gracias.
Okay, the next writer is Eduardo Mitre. Eduardo is from a poet from Bolivia. He's a professor at St. John's University. He published, among others, books, Morada, Mirabilia, Desde tu cuerpo, Razón ardiente, Ferviente humo, Elegía a una muchacha y Línea de otoño. His most recently book is El paraguas de Manhattan. You, Eduardo.
Thank you for inviting me to this important encounter. I really appreciate. I didn't know that we had to explain. The process of our writing. Very important question. I think that every poem has its own history. I could say that in general, I share the experience or some ideas and feelings and experience that have expressed my colleagues. To write every poem is a kind of adventure, mystery, and in general, for me, there are two kinds of poems, in my own experience. The short ones and the long ones. But when they are born, at the start, you don't know exactly if they are the extension of these poems. That there are some poems that are written in at the same moment the experience that inspires them, and others that take a long time. A long time that could be, I am talking about weeks, months, and even a year. There are many cases, in my poems, in my poetry, that belong to both of them. The instant writing, let's say, and if I can say that, and the poems that implies a very long, sometimes painful, but at the end, very happy, gratifying experience. I have tried to explain writing in prose some poems that took me, a year or even more to write them. And the problem was that another mystery that I have is, when do you know that a poem is finished? I think that everyone that writes, yes. When do you have the full shape, the complete shape of the poem? In this science, it's a battle with words, with form, as Lila has mentioned it. I start to write when I was 15, 16 years old. I think the most of the writers begin to discover the need of writing at this age, in the boyhood, because also in at that time, at that period of life, there is another experience, the need of the other. I am talking about you fall in love, you discover the other, no? So I think that both things are related. My poems in general, the figure of my poetry, I think is a transit, or let's say a double way, double tones. One of the celebration and the other of longing. I mean the presence of the reality, the world, and the longing for someone, for the absence. Oscillation, let's say. It's very clear in my poetry. I am gonna read now El Viento, The Wind. It was written in Brussels in 1995, more or less, and published in Madrid by Editorial Visor in 1998 in a book that has the title Camino de Cualquier Parte, which happens to be the third verse of the third line of the poem. El Viento, the wind, yes, of course, is the wind that blew at that moment, a strong wind, and that lasted all day long. At that time, we were in Brussels, where my son Gabriel was born, and very important for me also that. But we were, after 10 years, staying in Brussels. We went back. So the wind is that wind that blew then, but also it's the wind of my childhood in Oruro, in the high plateau, in El Altiplano. Also is the wind, let's say, the breath of words of the poem, the rhythm. It's also the wind that wakes up some souvenirs, remembrance, some faces, especially when it blows in the dream. Well, I am sorry to badly what more or less is written in this poem. El Viento. Thank you.
Not too close.
Retumba mucho.
Yes, the wind. It makes wind too close. I have talked about the.
Poner tan cerca porque hace
yeah.
Retumba.
But you have to direct me. That's okay?
Yes.
Bien, el viento pasa por esta calle como al comienzo, camino de cualquier parte. Pasa sin pensar en nada y todos ya piensan en una emboscada. Ala sol en el espacio. Bate puertas y ventanas, escapularios contra su paso. Tiemblan las cucharillas, las tazas, los platos, sin saber lo que pasa. Sembrador de reflejos, segador de miradas, pasa por los espejos sin que le vean la cara. En las mangas del árbol desliza el brazo y saca la mano llena de pájaros. Atraviesa la lluvia como un camello y pasa entero por el ojo de una aguja. Combate con el mar cuerpo a cuerpo y deja las olas con los crespos hechos trenzas de espuma. Baila con las palmeras reclinadas en su pecho y sabe en a bodas eternas la hora y el universo. Ávido de mundo, lame ciudades y puertos, no se detiene en ninguno peregrino como el deseo. Se interna en los hospitales, en el pecho de los enfermos y en las madres que nacen entre tánatos y eros. ir en espiral hacia adentro con el otoño en las hojas y abre el arca de los recuerdos en el sótano de la memoria. Pisa el pasado y camina a zancadas por los techos de calamina de la infancia. Entra en el altiplano, descarga la luna una cesta de astros y se lleva las nubes y el tiempo en la espalda. Cruza montes y cielos y no agravan su marcha ni la luz del regreso ni el ángel de la nostalgia. Solo un instante demora su aliento, solo entre la cabellera y el pecho de los amantes. Sopla por las noches en el árbol del sueño y florecen las voces desgajadas de los muertos. Sobrevuela el silencio y deja en cada palabra un alma y un cuerpo de su propia sustancia. Nadie hereda su genio, pero sí lo que él hace. Yo a su paso retengo esta estela de imágenes. Lo mismo que aquí, en el principio era el viento, y ha de ser en el fin sobre piedras y huesos.
I would like just to add, according to the questions that have been made before, I am sorry to ask, no, more or less to talk about the process, when did you start to write, all that. No, I would like just to add that, let's say, the second line, I mean the third line that I have mentioned, that gave title to the book, Camino de cualquier parte, was suggested many years before by Antonio Muñoz Molina. We were, you know, sharing a time in a bar, una tapa, una caña, and I remember he told me, I don't know how to translate, but I will profit the presence of Mariela, una copla flamenca that says, tu calle ya no es tu calle, sino una calle cualquiera, camino de cualquier parte. And he added, I hope that one day you will write a book or a poem with this title, Camino de cualquier parte. Well, I took it like this. I copied the La Copla. And then after years, like 4 years, when we went back to Brussels with my family, and this wind blew up, I started the poem that it's the first poem of the book, and it's the longest book that I have written. And like a touchstone, the first poem, and all, it gave title also to the book, Camino de cualquier parte. So there is, I mean, I am trying to say that the accident that collaborates in some way, el azar, the random, if you could say, that collaborates with a work of art. Not it doesn't matter how rational, consciousness do you have of the process of writing. There is always something beyond the logic. Why this verse, this copla came, it gave place and breath to write all the book. Well, thank you very much. Sorry.
Now let's present to this singular poet writer Freddy Amilcar Roncalla. Freddy is from Peru. He is a trilingual writer, Quechua, Spanish, and English. He is the author of Canto o Invocación a la Palabra, 1984, escritos Mitimaes, Hacia una Poética Andina Postmoderna, 1998. He has been also a translator between Quechua, Spanish, and English. With you, Freddy.
Thank you. Well, it's, first of all, thank you, Julio, and thank you, everybody, for inviting me here. It's an honor to share the table with you guys, because, you know, I mean, like everybody else, I have learned a lot, and for that, thank you very much. And I would also like to honor the students that are still here with us, and I think that, by looking at you reminds me the first times we were like young and we were trying to deal with this question, what's literature, what's writing, and all those things with all our heart. And I think that writing has to do with that, where are we, what are we, what's time, what's the being, or things like that that we don't no longer ask, but for some reason, writing allows us to have a deeper meaning of life, a deeper view of history, even your culture. Having said that, I remember that one of the first times I remember having written something was when my teacher in my small town in the Andes, Peruvian Andes, asked me to write something, so I went and wrote something in the blackboard about something that I don't want to mention. But she accused me of having copied the poem, and then she started crying because I was very moved. So I guess that was my first exposure to poetry. And then at that early age, I wanted to write prose. I wanted to write a novel, and I never finished writing a novel, but I will read something that is part of that project. I've been to school, I've been part of this half movement of poetry that we share with Mariela, this whole thing about the street, great admirer of surrealism and stuff, but I'm also part of the Andean culture, and I think of myself as an Andean writer who has come here for a long time, and I'm trying to put together those three languages and cultures in one text, sometimes not. Having said that, I like to pay homage to what I think the greatest genius of Peruvian writing, Huamantla Ayala, who was the first one, Felipe Huamantla Ayala, indigenous writer, who was the first one who bring about the idea of writing multilingual language writing and multi-language writing. This poem I'm going to be reading is a very short poem. It's in three languages, and they are like dispersed in the space and stuff, so every reading is different. I haven't looked at it in a long time, so we'll see what happens, and then we'll read something else. It has to do with translations of Quechua songs into Spanish, and about the impossibility of translating literally from Quechua to Spanish, because Quechua is a peculiar language, agglutinante. How do you say agglutinante? Agglutinated language, in which like you have the root and each syllable adds a different layer of meaning, which is very hard to translate into Spanish. So the best way for me at that point was to translate it as with poetical associations of certain songs. Cinco. Urpillaya erwichuchcha, flores tica, necesito ticaya tica. After the gondol flight, your silence flows on the wells of sound. The nameless, my love, para pronunciar, vasca y si mi manta, is some voice, tu nombre, y yarik yubikiman, yohak takishai. At the beginning of time, at the end, waira wasi kiman, Chayarimun, why, imanisparach, imanik tingrach, you are the center. We are Azucena, Pu, Margarita, Ri, Rosas, Chacuch, Clavel, Cap, y Jasminich, Pur Chacuch Kafti y Mainayara singing. Guainayay, caricia de viento sobre el pasto, the wind around the leaves, Hayachacusha y pequeño amor tan pequeño, ave de impulsos, de primordial flood derramados en el firmamento. Grows in the heart, cuya, amor, cha, pequeño, pequeñito, dulce anillo concéntrico de la emoción ciega, like a quiet mountain of light, cu, que cae en mi frente, y pisa una estrella en el pecho. Esja, olvidado y presente, y mío, yu, cuca, planta elemental, quintucha, perfecta, miniatura dulce y sagrada, ante, arde dance of dreams ante la inmensidad azul y marrón, la noche y el día, hoja redenda, evidente en tu silencio masticado con paciencia. The circle, Hansi dicen y achanque que sabe sola y compañera, the song follow step by step, the circle, the song follow step by step, ñoja de vidaita mi vida y manispara, sí, estoy, cae aquí, en el principio sin casa ni tiempo, al final, Bruno Basinki, lejos, around the boundless wing of time, your body de los demás, Guajarayaipas con la cascada en el pecho para atacar la huella de tu cercano cuerpo distante. It's always present. Cantando regreso solo con mi guitarra. Taruquita, jaña, jañan, linta, poca punchuyuan, traguta, guactaspa, mactallaya ya. When the day dreams, a llorar, malarrojoyo, mis penas, jamón y junto a mi ventana. Guayuyas jaita y acharayquipaj. And the night is another shape of your body, imarisparaj, tanca, espesura de espinas, kichkacha, mojada por la lluvia, lluviacita, rurusapacha, seminal, imanayaraj, ¿por qué será? Huyanguanquichu, ¿por qué serás? Imarisparaj, and the rivers of your bodies are another shape of music.
¿Tenemos tiempo?
This other, I had just mentioned that. Back then, when I began writing, I wanted to write a novel. And one of the things that happens to me is that, you know, I admire to all of you that finished so many books. I managed to finish two books, I don't know how. And, you know, like a lot of my work is a lot of work in progress, you know. So I, you know, published bits and pieces right here and there and stuff. And I believe in the, like, ephemeral use of words. And I also work in the flea market in New York. And you know, one of the things about the flea market in New York, I think that it's like a great poetic space where people come together, and that's like kind of a plaza, or kind of like a thing that we have like poesía la calle and stuff. And one of the things that happens that, you know, a lot of people that work in the flea markets in New York, at least, they are also somewhat poetics, you know. I mean, a lot of them are actually real poets themselves. And this is a piece I wrote when I was working in this flea market, Grand Street, and there was this old guy that used to come, and we always talk about different things. He was like a mathematician, a sculptor and stuff. We would talk about different things, and we will always end up with a kind of punchline, and like a week later, he'll come back with a poem with a punchline, you know. So we sort of have like this kind of beautiful conversation about poetry, and he will, you know, actually make the poems concrete. Of course, he told me that he never published his poetry, so I have like a bunch of his poems that I cannot publish because I have, you know, I don't know whether he's still alive or not, and, you know, I have no way of finding him. So, but it's a short fragment, and it also, you know, says, you know, that for the students, you know, like, just go for it, you know. I mean, it doesn't matter whether we write the masterpiece, you know. It's probably better off we don't write no masterpiece, you know, so we don't have to worry about Nobel Prize or anything like that. You know? Steve llega buscando fierros viejos en el suelo para sus esculturas. Poeta, matemático y diseñador de collares de residuos industriales, anda con un chaleco sucio y una cola de caballo. Uno nunca sabe cómo llega a conocer a estos viejos carismáticos que suelen mostrar un humor fútil y desprendido, a medio paso de la muerte y al margen de las convenciones, pero buscando cordones para amarrarse a la memoria y canchas para pronunciar las palabras no pronunciadas en la gran arquitectura de la soledad que es esta ciudad de solitarios. Me atrajo verlo pescar sus pequeños tesoros en el suelo como lo hacía en Cayete, caminando al borde de la Panamericana recogiendo pernos, guachas, latas aplastadas, pedazos de llanta que solía guardar en el techo del castillo de Drácula, que era donde vivíamos encima de una ferretería abandonada, a la que uno debía bajar por la claraboya con una escalera prestada o quemándose las manos con la soga al estilo Tarzán, para tirarse lo que quedaba de una antigua tienda y no usar nunca nada jamás. Buena conversación, y a la semana siguiente viene con un pequeño poema basado en ella. Desde entonces son muchos los versos escritos a mano que me llegan semanalmente como un tónico. Son breves, describen pequeños eventos que se elevan a lo poético en la línea final. Un poema más largo describe el acto de encontrar objetos en un botadero de basura, el otro el horror de una rata cazada por un gato, pero los demás son de corte lírico, la poesía, clave del mundo, el revés y el derecho del caos, mechero titilante en el cuarto oscuro de la memoria, hilo de telaraña en el viento, la poesía, matorral persistente, unas cuantas palabras que valen por grandes edificios mentales, por utopías, por monologismos, por mesianismos, monoteísmos, asaltos al cielo sistema, cambios del mundo, logocentrismos, silencentrismos, vagocentrismos, falocentrismos, grafocentrismos, silencio de centrismos, exilios impecables y mangoneros, deconstruccionismos, chacras marginales de exhibición, palabras y más palabras, torbellinos épicos nunca existentes, resaca de una borrachera estridente y olvido lírico. ¿Acaso en su chiquititud, la chiquititud de los poemas simples, aquellos los que el viejo encuentra en Soho hablando con la gente y pateando latas, son los que valen? ¿Son ellos la vela titilante en la noria de los alucinados? ¿O es que a los herederos de las lanzas puritanas no le pesan los bárbaros atilas y les brilla la evidencia tautológica como un seno desnudo? ¿Un poema es un poema? ¿No les pesa al mundo ni se les clava como una enorme piedra en el ego? ¿O tal vez solo es cuestión de ver lo poético en lo cotidiano? Lo decía el viejo Miller, para quien el estado de gracia debía ser más común que sorprendente. Lo decían también estos ferventos setentistas, un par de vueltas por la realidad, antes de irse a los grandes edificios derrumbados en bengalas de miedo, violencia, exilio, desaparecidos, canciones ahogadas, sueños encerrados, covachas del poder donde los guardianes del circo son los que antaño merodeaban la ventana.
Okay, now before we enjoy a wonderful choreography, Sonia Portugal is going to perform. We open now the time for question and answer. If you have a question to the writers, just ask. You have a question?
My name is Ed Coyne, I'm a student here. I'd like to direct this to Mr. Rancava, although I have no objection if anybody else picks up on it. I think it's generally agreed there's a renaissance going on down in Latin America. It has been suggested by many people that if there is a qualitative difference between what is happening there in the literature, between them and European and North American poetry. I know in Europe and in North America, the poet is an artist, a craftsman. He builds things, the stuff he does comes out of himself. In the indigenous cultures and their literature, I have in mind a Quechua. The poet really is a shaman, or so I have been told. And channels this inspiration. Now, question, is there a qualitative difference between Latin American literature and the father of literatures. Is there an interview with the different concepts in the creative practice between the indigenous peoples and the Europeans impact at all? If they impact, how do they impact?
In Quechua, we'll say Chechillo. Well, you know, the thing is that I think that one has to be very careful, you know, like attaching shamanistic or lies to like things that might not be shamanistic. I think that also that, you know, one of the things if you want to understand this, you know, or have a first understanding of Quechua poetry is true songs. You know, I think that, you know, especially YouTube, there's like a big body of Quechua songs that, you know, that can bring about poetry. There's also a renaissance of Quechua poets, at least in Peru, I think we're probably in Bolivia and other places too. What I think that the most interesting part about this is that the whole there's a sort of a tectonic shift in the way poetry is being conceived throughout the world as with the emergence of indigenous voices in poetry. I think that you know something that we have talked about. Oh yeah, okay, sorry, yeah, sorry. It's like a lot of different ideas to I think that you know one of the things that has to be addressed is that there's a sort of a tectonic there's a tectonic shift in the way Quechua or indigenous poetry is perceived around the world. As far as like 30 years ago, if you talk about indigenous poetry or Quechua, it will be like something so alien to us. You know, I think that's something that, you know, it was perceived as being so far away from modernity. It was part of like indigenous thing, backwards and so on and so forth. In the last 10 years or so, there's a change, you know, in which like the indigenous poetry, you know, indigenous voices, not only poetry, but through art or painting, music and stuff, are being considered and being in the forefront of the creative process. And in that regard, yes, you know, I mean, there's definitely a difference with the European arts because there's not like this dialogue with indigenous between the European tradition. It's like mostly with the, you know, the Greek.
I bought four drinks for every poet there. Would they say that they were technicians or shamans?
Oh, como? No, so I think that you have to be mostly in not in a bar, but in a fiesta, and I don't think that you will get the chance to ask the question because you will be drunk with music and words. That's a different question.
It would take some lubrication, I understand that. They see themselves as poets in the European tradition rather than shamans, persons who are contacting the spiritual, the supernatural world.
I don't think the shamans call themselves shamans. You know, I think that you know the shamans call themselves shamans only when they have to deal with like the tourist industry. You know, that's something that we have to be very careful about. But the thing is that you know there's a body of poets. You know, they're publishing very active right now, and they will consider themselves as poets in the Western sense. You know, but I think that probably you know. Thank you. Sí. Bueno, yo creo que las cosas están cambiando, ¿no? Ha habido mucha violencia, mucha discriminación. En la guerra civil que hemos tenido en el Perú, Shall we switch into English? In the Civil War, we had like 7,000 people killed, and most of them were Quechua speakers. To the question of what I learned in the, in the Quechua communities, it's like the sense of communality, the sense of community, you know, and the music. You know, the music is, for me at least, something I forgot to mention, is the music is... yeah, you know, I mean, that, yes, but, you know, I'm beginning to discover that the sense of sadness is just like a layer of meaning that, you know, actually brings you to a different realm, which will be like a higher realm of consciousness, you know. So it's just like a gateway, you know. So it's not to be taken too seriously, really. No, I didn't understand the question.
I'm saying your perspective on the
yeah.
Is that they feel happy with what they have right now?
No, not at all. Not at all. It's, there's a lot of conflicts there, you know. It's not an idyllic place.
What is the main one?
Right now, the main one has to be with land. You know, and one is land, and the other one is like the whole issue with the mining companies. You know, land. You know, land, water rights. You know, mining companies, you know, ecology, and things like that. So that's is. Yeah. Well, there are different ways of resistance, you know. I mean, I would say that, you know, like even the resurgency of like Quechua literature is a form of resistance. You know, there are sindicatos, you know, unions, you know, different like, you know, like. You know, it's something that we could talk about for a long time. It's very complicated. You know, I mean, like all Peruvians, we really don't understand what Peru is about. It's so hard. You know, we could talk about it later on if you like. You know.
Okay. Next question, Professor Lorena.
I would like to go back to the creative process.
I think the main relationship for me with music is the rhythm, mostly, because when you write, when you're in the process of composing, which is different from the process of edition of a poem, for me, Really, the poem becomes a poem when you enter into a certain rhythm of the language, which leads you to a different space or a different way of saying things than the literal. So it's the rhythm of, it has to do also with the rhythm of the language, but it's a bodily experience also at the same time. Like when you're listening to music and you're moving a little bit, is when you get into the rhythm of the music, when you begin to dance, when you really enter into the rhythm of the music, you're really dancing. If not, you're like moving like this, and you're not dancing. It's the same with the writing. There is a certain moment that you enter into this rhythm, and everything connects through sound. It's the sound that begins to bring meaning at the same time and different connections between the words. So I think this is the relationship between poetry and music in a way. And also I think, as you notice when you hear poetry readings, that everybody has their own sound and their own rhythm and their own tone. There is the matter of tone that is very important, because it's not like something very flat. It has variations also. And the text has its variations. We notice maybe those variations more when the poet is reading, but those variations are part of the, on tone, are part of the text also. And really, I living in the United States, I became very aware of the sound of the language, because for me, English is like a very soft language, and it's very wavy. No, so I try to like limar, ¿cómo se dice? Limar?
File it.
Eh?
File it?
No, like smooth. To smooth the Spanish in this kind of wavy English, let's say. I don't use like a lot of words in English, but I like very much like these wavy tones of. And I heard, for example, after I was writing like that, I heard an American poet who is called Mei Mei Bersenbrugge. She's Chinese and American. And I saw a lot of similarities in the way of reading and the perception of the language. And I don't know, I didn't know it, but she was she was a big influence for me. In Spanish, of course, and I'm very aware of the oral part of language. In Spanish, I'm an admirer of Gabriela Mistral, who was the first woman, the first Latin American writer, either men or women, who got the Nobel Prize in 1945. And she treated language like this in a very sound word also. I mean, in the rhythm, the rhythm and the sound of her poems are amazing.
Well, I think I am the only person here who writes only prose. I write narrative, but even in the narrative, everything you write, for example, in the narrative, this is interesting. Even when you write, trying to imitate the oral language, which I do all the time, many times, for example, not in this story I read here, and people think many times, you know, people tell me, oh my God, that sounds exactly, you know, what you are listening to the person you are. And it's not true. It sounds like that, but just to get to that point, you have to work a lot. Mm-hmm. Because when you, the prose, everything you write, it has to have, you know, a rhythm. Hmm? Many times it's not the word you choose, it's just the position of the word. Hmm? And even many times, I heard about this many, many times before. I was really writing so much, and it's true, even in the prose, even in a story, even in a novel, sometimes you change something, that is the meaning, because the word, the other word is better. You can change sometimes, for example, a prima, cousin, for a sister, hermana, that is just because it, when you read it, you know, it's harmonioso, it's better. This is a, of course, you know, the relation with the music is obvious. You need the rhythm, the rhythm in the intonation, in the, and what I say, even if you are using the oral language, that oral language has to be worked very carefully.
Just complimenting what they both said is like the idea of measurement that gives you a rhythm. And in that case, I mean, syllables count, letters count. Whether they are vocales fuertes or vocales débiles counts. And what happened to me when I was writing my fourth collection, PES, which is related to September 11th, it was not related originally. What I had planned to do was to make like a parallel between the gestation of the word and the gestation of a human body as two similar processes, in the sense that they are very personal, they are unique, and they are a process, both of them. But September 11th came on the way, so the images of love and creating were combined with images of destruction. But at the end, I guess there is some hope in the poem because life imposes itself upon death. But I realized later, afterwards, that a few lines in these poems have this particular rhythm because they are written in endecasílabos, 11 syllable lines. But this came to me naturally. I was not aware of it while I was writing, but there are some passages, some sections of the poem, because it's really, PES is like one lengthy poem, that are like very rhythmic. And I learned, I remember later that endecasílabo fits the Romance languages very well, because it's a pattern that allows you to breathe in a certain way, and you pause after 11 syllables and you go on like in a very rhythmic way, and you can go on and on like for a certain fragment or for a few stanzas like that. PES is being translated into English now, and I met with my translator last weekend, so that's why I have this in mind. She resolved to use the iambic pentameter, which is what is the closest meter in English for this. So it was a whole operation also, because I not only work with rhythm and meter, I do a lot of work with syntax itself, to distort syntax a lot. Even though my language is very clear and I don't use very complicated words, I try to turn syntax, you know, la torsión de la sintaxis. And that, I think, both Fred and I might agree that we learned that great lesson from Vallejo, who is our poet, you know. And it's funny because I use a line by Vallejo in my poem, with the poem I read, this idea of el traje que vestí mañana comes from Trilce by Vallejo. And I realize Freddy uses the Barbaros Atilas, which is also Vallejo's half a line, you know. So he's our father, whether we acknowledge it or not.
More questions? One more question? You want to ask a question?
I want to ask that as writers, when you write, do ideas come from your imagination, or does your background and experience have a greater impact?
You guys answer now. Eduardo,
I think that you cannot write in general with ideas. I mean, the ideas are implicit, no, in the experience you have, in the feeling. And I would like to underline that, in general, to write a poem, it's a, a discovery, a process. You don't know where are you going exactly. Do you understand what I mean? It's not irrational, but it's a process that takes you to somewhere, but it's a process that implies language that implies experience, feelings, ideas. So you write with all your senses. You write with your breath. You write with your soul and your body. That's what I can tell you.
Okay. Unfortunately, we don't have enough time. We have to cut here with the questions. I want to send to the writers to come here. Okay, writers to come here to share with us their poems and sharing with us their experience, and giving you a big applause for coming here.